My name is Matan. The reason I got interested in reproducible research is that I did a research project in Yale University, and for my other advisor, who's an harmonic analyst and applied mathematician, and what happened is that our computational research got out of control. We had this humongous software system, and you're obviously all familiar with these problems. There was a pipeline analyzing data and producing results, many results, and there were like 200 parameters in the system, and nobody could understand anything we're doing. So I started thinking, and then I approached Dave with some ideas, and this is basically the result. So I'll use a blackboard because, you know, obviously you're going to forget everything I have to say. But try to remember this. No more files. And maybe also I'll write that people are lazy and just want to publish. Yeah. Obviously. So the thing is that, I mean, keep that, I mean, if you'll forget everything I have to say, just keep this in mind. So I'll take 35 minutes and hopefully we'll have some time for questions. This is Dave. He couldn't be here. But a better part of what I have to say is Dave's ideas. So if you have a mobile device and with a QR reader, you can take it out because you can actually interact with parts of my talk. There are many QR codes. So here is a famous quotation in the history of reproducible research. Have everyone seen this before? I'll read it. So an article about computational science is not scholarship itself. It's merely advertising of the scholarship. Now, this dates more than 20 years ago. And this is like repeated in every session, every talk about reproducible research. Did we really advance since then? So this was paraphrased by Dave in 95 in the famous wavelet paper. So actually, we in this room do not need what I have to say because we are reproducible research fans and we try to follow reproducible research practices. Outside this room, and I'm going to be harsh because, you know, I haven't met most of you yet, only some of you, but I've been talking to these ideas about people from outside the RR community, but here I feel at home, so I'm going to be harsh and direct. Nobody expects or enforces reproducibility, really. If you publish in Science and they want your data, you can send them anything. Let's face it. And there are no uniform standards for reproducibility and no established user base. We are very far from this point where there is a lot of data that is structured and shared uniformly and so on. So that's harsh truth. And, pretty recently, there was John Ioannidis, now in Stanford, says most published scientific research, it was mainly in the medical science, is false. So we didn't really get anywhere since 95. And we have Keith Bagley with the Duke affair says that it's not reproducible and maybe somebody you know got some sort of into clinical trial and got something that actually didn't help them at all. Okay, and this was because the p-values in the paper were not tied to anything real. Huh? Why? So what have we learned in the last 15, 20 years of people coming up with solutions and failing to become standard? Any solution that has to become, in order to become standard, it has to be realistic. It has to be legally realistic. And it has to be technologically realistic. It has to be easy for everyone to adopt today. So as much as I fancy various authoring's environment and so on, people are lazy. They're not going to budge a millimeter from their workflow, from their environment. They're not going to adopt your nice system. That's not going to happen. They're going to stay in their platform. And finally, you have to give them some perks to even do a very marginal shift. So suppose you give them something that is doesn't take any effort to use. It's mindless to use. It's very easy. Everybody can do it. Even then, you have to give them some perks. So saying, I raised the RR banner, follow me, did not get us anywhere. People will not share their data just because you're nice. They might do it if you bend their arm, and they might do it if you give them something in return, something real. And by everyone, and this maybe is not a very common practice to say that, but this has to include researchers, authors, readers, but also publishers, because if publishers don't get anything out of it, then they won't play ball. So this talk is about another solution that was designed to become standard. We thought hard about why nothing worked, and we tried to solve it. And it's all about the scientists not in this room. So when you've seen our solution, there were many. There are great things like S-Weave. I'm crazy about S-Weave. Think about all the people that are lazy, that want to publish, that are not you, they do not raise the RR banner, and think about whether they are going to use it. So here is our vision. This is some paper from somewhere, but I like it because it has many sorts of computational results. It has images, and it has bar charts, and it has tables, and it has more tables, and so on and so forth. So our vision is that every one of these computational results will have a barcode, a unique identifier. This is the title of my talk, Identifier for Computational Results, that will be a seal of quality and will lead to a detailed chronicle or account of how this result was generated. Because people want to publish, they are committed to the end game. If their p-value is not low, if their image is not pretty, the paper will not get accepted. Okay? So in the entire reproducible research zoo of problems, think about the end game. The computational results, the bottom lines of your research, they have to be accounted for. Okay? And work your way from there. This is what we call a VRI, so a verifiable result identifier. This is a cartoon for a scientific result. In a paper, this would be a hyperlink, and it would have a barcode. Okay? So actually, if you have, let's do it now. If you have a QR reader, and suppose these are my lecture slides, right? I have a QR reader here, and this is of a cheap gimmick, but it's somewhat powerful, so let's do that, right? So what I got on my mobile device was, just what I'm getting if I'm clicking. So this is served to you courtesy of the VCS server in Stanford, and this is the result. And there is metadata about the result. And it was created by a computation. This is a computation. This is the code that ran. This is the, if you'll enlarge a bit, so this is MATLAB function. It had two input variables, original image and in, which are like parameters. You can go and see them, and so on. This is the data. And I'll show you the API. You can retrieve it in various formats, so on and so forth. Okay? So before we launch into the details, this is our vision. And it's already a reality. Just a second. It's already a reality because, I mean, it's a service that's running to some extent. Yes?
So what was the name of the app that translated that into a link?
Come again?
The application that on your tablet.
Oh, a QR reader. So any QR reader. I'm using...
QR reader?
Yeah. So this is called the QR barcode, QR code. You see them around. This encapsulates just a URL. So just if you have a mobile device, you need a QR reader. That's all. Okay. So, and actually, so this is a nice idea. I mean, come on, it's catchy, and I got your attention. But actually, there is so much more to it. Okay, think no more files. So now suppose that any result has a unique identifier, and it lives on a server. Okay, it was validated when it got on the server, and now it's valid. Then we can have, maybe we can uncover the entire zoo of computations, the entire network of computations that we all know exists but was never exposed before. So this is the paper. The paper has a barcode. You go from the PDF to the image, to the computation that generated the image. The computation used two data sets. You go to this data set. This data set was also used by another computation, so on and so forth. Okay? So when I say no more files, I mean that all these things are entities with identifiers and with API, so application programmer interface behavior, so you know exactly what you can do with them. They live somewhere in the cloud, say, and there are no more files. So in the research flow I'm going to describe, there are no EPS files, because I'll show you a LaTeX plugin, and we can have a word plugin as well. that allows you to take the identifier and put it in your paper. No EPS files, no JPEG files, and no data files as well, because I'll show you how you can import data using the identifier into your workspace. Make sense? Okay. So this was like the large picture, and I want to take a few minutes to describe why we're doing all that, why this is better than anything else, and so on and so forth. So I'm going to say some harsh thing about the reproducible research community now, but they have to be said. A scientific experiment has initial conditions, specified steps, and observed results. This has been the case since Newton. A lab journal is a reproducibility standard for experiments, which is a detailed account of the conditions and steps that led to published results. And this exists all over the experimental disciplines, like chemistry, physics, biology, whatever. Fine. We try to skip that because we believed in re-executability. For many years, the discussion was focused about not how to follow this nice tradition about chronicling the steps that led to a result, but about re-execution of programs. And this kind of failed, in our opinion. So if you want to be reproducible, you have to give me a makefile that will re-execute your experiment and give me the figures. This is John Clairbout's legacy. This is not technologically realistic as we know full well, because actually, just like dinosaurs, computer systems expire and go extinct as well. Okay, so I can read COBOL code, but I cannot execute it almost anywhere these days. It's not easy to adopt, and it doesn't have real benefits. So, okay, so if you run after the scientist and you say, give me the makefile, or like some very noble people do, give me a library that will allow me to reproduce the result, nobody is going to do it, because it takes too much work, there are no real benefits, it's not easy to adopt, and so on and so forth. And actually, moreover, it ignores the scientific tradition that I mentioned about chronicle experiments. Everybody, for hundreds of years, have been doing the following. They have a lab journal. They do something, they write it down. They do another thing, they write it down. They go to the publishable result, okay, and they have the lab journal. And this, I'm not an expert, but this protects their IP and so on. In Nobel lectures, sometimes you can go back to the lab journal where the discovery was made. Okay? We don't have that. So many of what I have to say sounds a lot like the system from yesterday. Sumatra. I just learned about it 2 days ago, so I mean there are many parallel lines and we should definitely discuss them. The effort to become re-executable ignores the hard truth that publication is the end game. So I'll show you how you can sort of twist their arms and say, you want to publish? Fine. You'll use the system that doesn't cost you anything. It's very easy to use. But in the runtime, as the computation progresses, during the experiment, you will disclose everything that you have to disclose. Not 2 weeks after the fact, not some obscure file. Something will happen without you even controlling it. It will take what it needs, validate your results, and then your p-value will get a nice green V so it can be published. And this is trying to cope with the human nature. This is committing to the end game. Here are two statements that Dave made in the AAAS meeting in DC. Half a year ago? The all important publication is an informal description of work you do in private, and all of reproducibility currently involves cleaning up post-facto. It's a pretentious waste of time. So who am I speaking with you like that? But this is Dave's words. And he was leading or attempting to lead the discussion in ARA for many years now. So it's worth listening, maybe. So here's our alternative approach. Verifiable computational results, VCR. We automatically record, validate, and validate runtime steps that lead to the publishable results. I'll show you how that's possible. And just using a cartoon, here is the source of all our trouble. You read the paper, there's a nice image. Once upon a time, there was a computer taking a data set, producing the image. There was a computation taking place. I mean, on the machine, functions were ran. Arguments were given. Output arguments were given, right? But then it's gone. because nobody took the effort of recording that. So what you publish is a JPEG. And remember, files are the source of all evil because you can tamper with JPEGs, right? They are not connected to the research. And people actually do tamper with JPEGs. Or just accidentally send the wrong JPEG with the paper. Okay? And they sometimes send the data. So these are harsh words for the data sharing policy. You can require people to send you files all you want. If you cannot validate what they have sent you, automatically it's worthless. And I couldn't find it now, but in response to the NSF data sharing policy, some blogger wrote the following. Sure, we'll send you 18 gigs of unannotated files in UTF-16 because we an obscure character set. And I mean, this is our data. So you want something that takes
that's
the data.
That's not what it asked for.
Sure, I mean, but the thing is, you have to have the manpower.
If they had any teeth, then next review, he wouldn't get his grounds.
So do you actually have the manpower to go over teras of data and see that they are correct?
That's what NIH have not done, and not clear that NSF will do
that. I see. Okay, so this is, it has to be done automatically. We agree on that. We have to validate automatically because there is no manpower to do that. Okay, so think about this thing. We are going to record the computation as it progresses and keep this connection intact. So a record of a computational experiment includes everything you can imagine. Code, original data, parameters used in runtime, publishable and immediate results, and dependencies. So if you go deep enough, you can re-execute. You will have enough information to re-execute. You can even package the entire environment in which the experiment took place. But that's not the key point here. It's not about re-executability. It's about validation. Getting the data that you know is right, and being able to understand what's going on. If I give you a makefile and you run it, you execute. You never understood what went on. Okay? So these VCR records are permanent and are citable. And as you see, interestingly, not only can you reference your peers' papers, you can reference all these, their code, their data, their parameters, and so on, not only in your papers, but also in your computer programs. Okay, so people get cited directly for their data. So we've actually implemented that, and we built a VCR foundation that allows us to record and transmit, automatically validate, generate a unique identifier that connects anything to the article figure, and I'll show you an API that allows you to crawl this data and write applications that use this data. Okay, for example, think about a meta-analysis in medical research. If you can crawl p-values, automatically get their underlying data sets, in a very concrete sense, you can do automatic meta-analysis, which is a far-out vision for the future. But this is actually possible if there are enough people using this thing. Okay, so in order for anything to be useful for mankind, it has to become standard. If this becomes standard, we'll be able to discover knowledge in kind of new and exciting ways. So finally, the outline of my talk. I'll show the foundation API. I'll discuss briefly how we go about chronicling computations and show you some VCR applications that allows you to use the information that is stored on the server. So how does it work? VCR.stat.stanford.edu, you can go there. It's a VCR repository server. What it does is listen through an API to computations that are taking place and ask the computations hard questions. Okay, it breathes down your neck and it will not give you a kosher sign unless your computation gave enough information. That makes sense. This is about chronicling the experiment as it's going on. As the experiment progresses, there is a lab diary that annotates and validates. The second ingredient in the foundation is the addressing standard. This VRI here, I'm pointing to myself. This VRI here is a URL, so you get the domain of the repository, the server, but also some kind of a string here that's a secure digital signature. And in hard copies or lecture slides, it appears as a QR barcode, so you can actually scan there. So this is actually kind of cool. You are in a poster session, and you don't believe something you see. You go to their computation. You read a paper, you don't believe the figure. You click on the figure, you go to the computation. You browse the computation. Okay? And finally, the last part of the foundation is this API that allows you to write applications that take this data. So let me show you an example. So when I clicked on this brain image before, I went here, right? Okay? This is just a graphical rendition. Underlying this graphical rendition, there is an API that allows you automatically, this is a JSON format, that allows you to automatically mine data about the computation. So for example, this is a result by the name of Sigma. It was created by this computation. So we can go to, you can ask to see the creator of this computation. This is the source. Okay, so it's just showing you small characters on the screen, but the point is that you can write computer programs that very easily mine all this data and search all this data. Okay, so here's a far-out search. If enough of us use these things, we can search for who used SVD in the last 6 days in a biology journal. Okay? Or you published code. Who used your code? You published data. Who used your data? Because there are no more files. Because there are IDs. Okay? All right. If any of these does not make sense, it's very natural. So just please ask questions and so on. Actually, you can also nod or look granted. I discovered that it's very useful for the lecture. Shoot.
So you use the term standard format a few times.
Sure.
What do you propose as a standard format for all scientific data?
So there is HD?
HDFS.
I think it's the leading candidate, but this question is a big issue, and it has a...
I guess my observation is you sort of subsumed the 45-year unsolved data integration problem to... to deliver this.
Let's see. So, I'm a budding statistician. If in the statistics community that just use R and specify data formats, well, we don't have to solve the cosmic problem of it. Just a second.
So this is a system for statisticians.
So, in as much as you have a standard data format or ways or converters to convert between data formats, this works. And so, let's see. In communities, no problem, usually, right? And in my experience, if you use HD5 and basically everything you want to do, you can do with it. And in the future, you'll have to convert. Obviously, if you take this problem to enough generality, it's not solved yet. But in our daily existence, it's kind of solved. You disagree? Okay, let's take it offline. So, fine. How do we chronicle computations? So. The way we do it is we alter the programming language syntax a bit, okay? So the example I have to show is MATLAB. The same works easily for high-level scripting languages, and with a little more effort, anything that is programming-like. So not spreadsheets, but programming-like. For example, C++, Java, R, Python, Perl, Ruby. So the way it works is as follows. Regular program code creates a plot and saves the plot to a file. Files are bad. What we have is we connect to a repository. This is syntax in your program. You declare who is going to be monitoring your computation. Make sense? Okay, I'll show you that in action in a second. And then instead of writing your usual creation instruction, you proceeded with a verifiable modifier. And what happens is that behind the scenes, the repository and your machine speak, and the data is delivered, and you don't have to do anything about it. It's very easy to use. Okay? Moreover, you control what you are submitting. You don't submit everything. You submit things that you are going to publish. And as I'll show you, unless you do use this modifier, your PDF will not compile. So it's a good way to control the lazy people. Their PDFs will not compile unless their p-values are created this way. Okay?
So I have a question.
question. Yes. So where are you inserting this?
This is program code.
I know, but where? Python, R, what are you doing this in? So my question actually is really, what are the requirements for plot so that verifiable is going to work for it?
So it currently works with R, Python, and MATLAB. And what it needs is a plugin. So somebody writes a small piece of software that implements these things. So if you use a very obscure version of Ruby, you'll have to write your own plugin. You can do this because there is a defined API. You know exactly what you have to implement.
Okay. So basically, you need to wrap whatever you want to put verifiable.
Yes. The thing is that
just like workflow systems require that people wrap modules to call these things.
Yes.
Okay.
But we tried hard to make very small changes to the environment. The thing is that we discovered that because people are lazy, they will not migrate anywhere. They will not do anything unusual for them. They might add a modifier. That's not a big deal. But that's the extent of it. Okay? And now there is no local file created. So this computational experiment did not result in any EPS file. It resulted in a line on your screen saying, this is the identifier for what you just created. Let me show you how it works. There we go. So this is MATLAB through a very slow X11 connection. Wake up.
Sorry, quick question.
Sure.
If you rerun that same piece of code, does it create a new URL for the image, or will it reuse the same?
So it's kind of delicate. The data itself does not get a new identifier. The identifiers are characteristic. So if you have exactly the same data set, they will have the same identifier. But a data element is wrapped in some metadata. That is, who created it, when, and where. This will be new. Okay, so if you create a new terabyte of data, the new terabyte of data does not have to be deposited anywhere. But there is a new metadata object saying, you created it using this computation, using this source code, it used these parameters, on this time, from this IP, so on and so forth. Okay?
So do you keep track of things about versions? Like if I generate several files with the same program, it's useful knowledge in terms of governance to know that the files are versions each other. Do you keep track of that?
So any files? I have results.
It's not files, but the file is what we name, say, the intermediate result that has a unique identifier. Part of the unique identifier is going to be the signature of the program of code.
Yes,
code,
absolutely.
Right? It's hash, right? Something that is based on the context. So there's some things that can uniquely identify.
Sure.
Right? But it's also important to know that things are versions of each
yes.
other.
Yes. Well, you can very easily integrate it with a version control system. We have not. Okay. So there are no versioning currently. So here's how it works. To connect to a repository, so this is MATLAB. Fine, it's a scripting language. So now I'm connected to the repository. Suppose I'm creating a... So I have a figure here. A live demo in lectures is always tricky. So bear with me. So I created this result, fine. It's a result.
You're not using Lena?
Was that? Yeah. Yeah. I should have. And this is the instruction. Is it too small for you? It's okay. So verifiable monkey equals H. H is the handler for the graphics. We are going to submit. Now we are in image processing. We are going to submit a result of some image processing algorithm. That's an image. That's the way we do it. We no longer save a local file that can be photoshopped by some people in the darkness of the laboratories. We do it in real time. And there is a repository breathing down our neck. Does that make sense? Okay. So there is no local file created. But what there is this signature. So let's go to my browser. Oh, there you go. Fine. So this just happened, okay? So you can see it was generated from the IP of UBC just now and so on and so forth. Okay?
stored somewhere?
Okay, so this was created by command line.
Yeah.
Yes, but let's look at another example. So another example I have is a kind of a cartoon of an image processing research. These are all cartoons, just to make the point. So I have an experiment in image processing that does the following. Takes, it's a function. If you can't read, just let me know, okay? It takes some original image and some tuning parameters. It corrupts the image and then recovers the image and calculates some SNR, okay? A cartoon of research. Okay, so there's original data here and so on. In the old workflow, what you do is you take this local file, feed it into the program, create the recovered image, save it as EPS, send to the publisher. This disconnects the result from everything that's happened that is gone forever. Okay? Now, using VCR, here is just a launch script for VCR. So you connect to a repository. These are the tuning parameters. And you record even the random state of the random seed as a verifiable result. And now, this is a very, very interesting line. It's a function call. You see the function call here? See that? It's preceded by modifier chronicled. This tells the plugin, so actually there are three new words in VCR. Repository, verifiable, and chronicled. That's all. It's easy enough. You precede the function call with chronicled, you tell the plugin or whatever is running on your machine, record the code, record the parameters, verify everything, send to the repository. Okay? And the cool thing is that we do not give it a local file. Instead of giving it a local image, we take an identifier. This should be disturbing for you because it's very different than what everybody has been doing. See the identifier here? It's fed into the function. There are no more files. Okay? So what it does is cite the guy with the original data. Okay? Because now the code is on the repository. It's searchable. You can count citations. So this is a citation by the person who's doing the experiment, me say, to the person who created the original data. And it's created in runtime. You don't have to do anything to make it happen. You cannot tamper with it. And it's permanent, so it's just there. Shoot.
How easy is it to set up a repository? How easy is it to, for example, make something on the repository or coupling? Have there internet access? You still want to work?
So I have a repository on my local machine with the IP, a local host.
It's easy to set up?
Yes. Yeah.
So after we have something similar, and we use Git. Right, and with Git, they will actually copy everything locally whenever it's not automatically.
So
this is not an issue.
Actually, how do I have it? Because I'm kind of...
Well, I don't know.
Okay. So the thing about Git is that Git solves another community's problems. Git solves, it's great for software developers. We, unfortunately, are not software developers. The chain of provenance and the interconnections that we have to follow is different than versioning. Okay? Because we have this network of computations that are feeding off data and generating new data.
Sure.
So VCR is...
Well, actually, in this case, when I'm saying Git, I just use it as like the underlying repository, right?
I see.
The provenance is on top layer.
Sure. That makes a lot of sense. Okay, so let me now fire the experiment for you. If the internet will be so kind.
Take 5 minutes.
Take 5. Time is anyway. Yeah, okay. So let's go back to the slide. So you run the experiment, all you get is strings. One string, two strings, three strings, four strings, no files. Okay. So instead of this image, which is no longer valid, this is the image you have. There is a repository. Could be your own local machine, could be a publisher's machine, could be the NSF machine, whatever. It's always in the cloud. I mean, usually it's in the cloud. Because we're talking about massive data storage. Sure. But if you talk about NSF, they can breathe down everybody's neck in a very real way. Because as the computation progresses, The repository is asking questions, and unless the questions are answered, there will be no VRI, so no identifier. And your LaTeX will not compile it, I'll show you very soon. So, and when the computation ends, the results are on the repository. So the code is published in runtime, no intervention is possible or required. The researcher can control the granularity, so you can choose private VRI. If you're doing a clinical trial and you want to hide your patient's data, you can do that. The repository will take notice, and there is a system of rules to handle private or proprietary data or code. And the repository validates, signs, and signs the computational result. So the architecture is very, very simple. There is a repository, the API on top of it. On top of the API, you write plugins. So we wrote some plugins. You can write your own plugins to let you use basically any programming-like research platform around. It's not hard to write them. So let's talk about VCR applications, which is how you use the data once it's deposited. And I'm going to claim that if enough people use this thing or anything like it, we will see new kinds of research emerge. Let's see why. So I'll talk about direct data import, a word processor plugin, a context browser, and search, and mention some others. So direct data import. Remember that this is no longer the scheme of things. This scheme is the source of all our troubles because the computation is gone and then we have nothing left. So this is the scheme. So direct data import means that after the computation is finished, there is a data set on the repository and it can be imported into new computations, further computations, right? So the way it works is just like I showed you. Instead of loading some CSV file, which may have been or definitely has been tampered with in the darkness of some lab, okay? Or just by mistake, by some, I mean, the entire Duke affair was a simple annotation error, right? Instead of that, and feeding it into a function, you feed the identifier to the function. There are no formats anymore because your plugin negotiates the data format with the repository. So we don't care about CSV or whatever anymore, okay? So this is actually a citation because like I mentioned, you can count citations. So all these poor groups that generate data and never get cited for it properly, you can now count these number of citations. Okay, is it clear that this is a citation for whoever made this data? That's important. No, yes, sad, happy, out of time. Okay, so this is a direct data import. The word processor application is as follows. Remember I mentioned, right now when we are publishing, we are sending a LaTeX source, or word source. Actually, yeah, so I was just talking with the Vir people and they mentioned that LaTeX is this and word is this. I never knew that, yeah. In the world out there. Yeah, so instead of sending files like JPEGs and PNGs and so on, what you do is as follows. You forget about the include graphics instruction in LaTeX. Are you familiar with this instruction? It is the source of all your trouble. You understand why? Okay? This disconnects forever what happened on your computer with your paper. They are disconnected. And this and everything you have to say post facto, yeah, you know, this is the code I ran, this is data I used, this is meaningless because no human will ever validate that. Okay? Instead, forget about include graphics, we have a new LaTeX instruction, include result. What you do is you enter the VRI of some graphical result. When you compile your LaTeX, what would happen? The LaTeX compiler would try to grab the result. If the repository says, I didn't sign this, I don't know what it is, then your LaTeX will not compile, okay? So now think about NSF reports or paper submissions. The publisher says, you know what? Your LaTeX didn't even compile because the p-value, it doesn't have a VRI produced by our server. Please re-execute the computation using our server as a monitor and resubmit. And don't submit anything except the LaTeX source, okay? And this is actually going on today. I want to show you there we go. So this is a PDF I submitted with Boaz Nadler to this is the last paper I submitted, okay? It's was submitted to what SIAM linear algebra. And there are some computations, like we all have. And this is the claim to fame of the paper, because everything, all the theory works, it works out, right? It's good, we beat the competitors, whatnot. Okay? So using VCR, this is how it looks like. Yes? Should never have bought a Mac. Oh, there we go. Okay, that's another example. So the LaTeX source of this thing is very simple. Instead of include graphics, it has include result. This is how the rendered LaTeX looks like. It's a hyperlink, and if you want it hard copy, it can have a QR code. And when you click on the hyperlink, let's click on it, you go to the computation. So this is the data, this is the code that ran, this is everything you need to know. Make sense? Okay. So this permanently binds the graphics to the content. So if you have no more files, you have no more Photoshop results or errors in submitting files and so on and so forth. Let's take it quickly. Okay, so that's the slide I showed earlier. That's what you get if there are enough people using this thing. All the papers are connected to the results. The results are connected to the computations that are connected to the data. Everything is there. Everything was validated in runtime. I want to point out that this solves some pressing issues in science that are basically all this conference is about. Mandatory data code sharing policy. So using this thing, your data will be shared, or there will be no paper, or no report. It will not compile. Okay? You do not send post-facto files that no human will ever validate. And we are talking about many, many publications. I think that there are, a million papers a year in the medical sciences these days? A million papers! A million! Who is going to validate all the data that is sent by email after the fact? Okay? So that's gone with VCR. Also, credibility concerns. For example, I know Dave told me that SIGGRAPH reviewers are getting emails saying, this is an anonymous email. Just know that this result has been photoshopped by someone. What do you do with such an email? I mean, you have the PDF, right? And you have the paper. What do? You accuse them of fraud? So using these things, there are no files, so there is no Photoshop. And I mentioned the perks that this should have for researchers, because researchers will not convert unless they have a very real benefit to them. So who runs the repository? You run your own. The publisher runs the repository. NSF runs the repository. But every research group runs the repository. So Tony said that he could not monitor the output of 200 faculty. If everything is submitted to the department repository, every computation that was executed is there. Everything in technical reports, everything in papers, but even things that were never published, they're just there automatically. So this is a huge benefit in order to, for people to manage the groups and so on. So this is a reason to convert. Let me skip that. Okay, so let me wrap up. Why we think this might become standard? It's very easy to adopt. Journals just print VRIs. It's not a big deal. And operate the repository. Researchers have to forget about files and use just these identifiers, which is not so hard to do and actually makes your workflow easy, and use this plugin to create the content and validate it. And readers, it's heaven for readers because every p-value, every image, everything is clickable. So it's actually realistic. It's easy to adopt, and it offers benefits. For everyone, we were here. I have a deja vu. There we go. So real benefits. Publishers become curators of computations. They will like this idea. Actually, they already like this idea. And it lets them stay in content validation, management, and addressing business. Some publishers try to let you re-execute computations. That will fail miserably because of security issues and even hardware resources. This is easy to run for a publisher. For authors, VCR applications are powerful knowledge discovery tools. Think about, you know, who ran SVD in the last 5 days in my group. For us in Stanford, it's very productive to use a group repository because it's a self-chronicling automatic lab journal. You don't have to record anything. It's all there. Just run a computation. It's all there. And suppose I finish my thesis, and it's on the library, and somebody does not believe something in my thesis. My thesis will have a QR barcode. It's a hard copy, right? It's just bound paper. It will have a QR barcode. You can go to this barcode and see the computation. And this will not expire in 10 years or 20 years because this is static content. On top of it, you can try to re-execute, fine. But this does not expire. And get explicitly cited for data. This is a huge perk for some researchers. And readers, again, just enjoy. So this is what we'd like to see papers. And actually, I invite you to think pessimistically about the history of reproducible research, because let's admit it, it did not pick up. There are great systems. There was a lot of effort, tremendous energy put into it. Nothing became standard. Why? So this was my point. And VCR is ready now for you to use. And we think it shows up a potential of becoming standard, which is actually a big step toward many things that have been discussed. So there is a paper in ICCS proceedings, and the vcr.sanford.edu is the website for all things VCR. And actually, if you want your repository on VCR stat, send me an email. I'll set you up. It's secure. So if the communication is secure, and the server is obviously secure, so you can just start using it. Thank you very much.